You're probably used to seeing solar installations that look like this. Solar panels facing up towards the sky, which, of course, makes a lot of sense. You want a wider area to catch more of that sweet solar energy, right? However, bifacial vertical solar panels have started to gain traction recently. Their more flexible footprint has innovators in Canada, Norway, and elsewhere testing them in all kinds of weird scenarios. People who are using these panels are reporting something odd: higher energy yield than expected. The energy yield stumped engineers, but a recent Dutch study may shed some light on the source of this extra energy. Have we been doing solar panels wrong this whole time, or is it all just a miscalculation? And how could this tech impact our lives? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. Before we can solve this mystery, what are bifacial vertical solar panels, also known as VPVs or BVPVs? I'm gonna have a really hard time saying that this entire video. We'll break it down into two parts. Now, first, look at this. Here they are, and they don't look that much different than your standard solar panel array. But there's a lot of things going on under the hood. You may not have noticed this yet, but there's actually photovoltaic cells on the back side of the panel too. So why? Well, we've explained how solar panels work in other videos, but here's a quick recap. You've got a silicon semiconductor complete with positive and negative sides. Sunlight hits our cell, knocking an electron away from a silicon atom, which is drawn to the negative side. Ideally, it's collected before it rejoins with the silicon. Now, the inverse happens on the other side of the semiconductor, creating a hole. Now, the two sides try to recombine, and bam, we get an electric current. The individual panels are connected together with bus bars to form one input and output terminal. Then, to protect all these components from the elements, the whole panel is sandwiched between a layer of glass and an opaque backing. And then that's all set into an aluminum frame for added durability. Now, this is a monofacial solar cell, and to put it simply, a bifacial solar cell, or BPV, replaces the opaque backing with more glass and occasionally a few other components. And at first glance, you might say, what's the point? These back panels will rarely, if ever, get direct sunlight. Aren't we always talking about how one of the biggest issues with solar energy is its intermittent nature? If cloudy days can significantly reduce their energy yield, surely facing solar panels away from the sun isn't going to do that much. And you're not wrong. But due to albedo, essentially which is reflected light, the bifacial cells can be up to 15% more efficient than their monofacial counterparts. This is especially true in high albedo locations like deserts or lightly colored rooftops. It also works for high albedo conditions like these troublesome cloudy days, when no one is getting direct sunlight at all, or when snow on the ground is bouncing a lot of light around. And I know what you're about to say, Matt, buddy, if these cells absorb extra light, then that's where the extra energy yields are coming from. Mystery solved. I'm sorry to tell you that the experts have already accounted for that. The mystery persists. Well, we haven't talked about the vertical part of the vertical bifacial solar array yet. Now, surely the extra energy must be related to that. Actually, no, at least not directly. Now, unlike our bifacial example, you can probably tell what's different about vertical solar panels right away. You also probably know that standard solar panels aren't exactly horizontal. To get the maximum returns on your solar panels, the general rule of thumb is to set them the same degree as your latitude. For example, I live in New England and my latitude is roughly about 42 degrees. So my solar panels ideally should be set to about 42 degrees. It's simple stuff. And generally, you're also going to want to point your panels south to maximize your sunlight hours too. So if angle optimization is so well understood, what's the point of vertical solar panels? Well, check out this graph. Now, these are the findings from a recent study conducted by the Leipzig University of Applied Sciences. As you can see, the BVPVs are deployed in an east-west orientation. They gather more energy in the mornings and early evenings. Now, compare that to these graphs on peak energy demand, and while not a perfect match, it does fit much more closely with our energy needs than standard horizontal panels do. So is this it? Did Leipzig crack the mystery of the higher yields? Nope. This is just a nice bonus and doesn't explain the extra voltage, but I've kept you in suspense for long enough. So let me reveal exactly where those mystery bonus yields are generated. If you're playing along at home, this is your last chance to guess, so write it in the comments. I'll wait. Actually, while we wait, this is the perfect time to talk about today's sponsor, Surfshark. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. Most of the time when we talk about VPNs, we're focused on giving yourself security as you travel around the world, but it can do way more than that. Since you can make it look like your IP address is coming from somewhere else in the world, it unlocks geofencing blocks on content, like streaming services. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices on your location, so you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best prices. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details like passwords have been leaked in online data breaches. So secure your privacy with Surfshark and use my coupon code UNDECIDED for an extra 3 months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. I've been using Surfshark for years now, and I love it. Link in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So to get your guests into the comments, well, to explain the mystery, we have to change the way we're looking at the solar panels, literally. Solar panels get hot. Of course they do, because they're baking in the sun all day. They're built to take it, mostly. Machines tend to perform worse as they get too hot. You've probably experienced this with an older phone or computer. Ever lift your smartphone up after sitting in a hot car? You may find that the phone displays a message that says too hot, meaning some functions have been disabled to prevent damage to the phone. Too hot differs from machine to machine, but even solar panels get a little too hot. Now, when they do, it results in a dip in operating voltage. As you can see here, a solar panel's voltage is influenced both by the amount of light and by the temperature of the solar cell. Increased sunlight or irradiance increases the voltage logarithmically. Frustratingly, the increasing temperature that usually comes with lots of hot, bright sunshine causes the voltage to decrease, usually by about 0.3 to 0.4% per degree centigrade. And right when solar panels should be performing their best, they start to struggle. One reason for this inefficiency is the increased Brownian motion as temperature increases. If we think of the atoms in a conductor or semiconductor as a vibrating lattice, the higher the temperature, the faster the atoms vibrate. If you're a little electron, representing our electrical current, you need to get through this lattice. It's much easier to get through a lattice that's moving slowly versus one that's moving quickly. In essence, most materials see an increase in electrical resistance with an increase in temperature. Now, this leads to the results of the Netherlands Organization of Applied Scientific Research, or TNO, study. Now, TNO installed a small vertical bifacial PV system in an east-west facing configuration in Petten, the Netherlands. They collected data from these panels and created a simulation with a digital twin. This allowed TNO a greater level of control over the variables and allowed them to more easily contrast the results with horizontal panels in similar conditions. Now, what they found will surprise you. As you can clearly see here, the vertical bifacial solar panels are much cooler than their horizontal counterparts. Why? Well, their heat transfer coefficients, a figure that defines how heat energy passes from one material to another, are much lower than expected. Now, this means they remain much closer to the ambient temperature, only half as hot as their horizontal buddies. Likely because their orientation and facing means that they can dodge some of the worst of the heat. Regardless, these lower temperatures mean less voltage is lost to overheating, which allows the vertical bifacial solar panels to generate more energy overall. The paper's author, Bas van Aken, put it this way. These lower operating temperatures have a positive effect on the operating voltage, and thereby on the total energy generation, particularly under high irradiance conditions. So how much more voltage do these vertical bifacial arrays generate? Well, up to 4% on very sunny days, equating to about 2.5% more energy annually. Now, this might not sound like much, but when it comes to this kind of optimization, even fractions of a percentage point are big news. Every little bit counts, especially when they're talking about something as scalable as solar panels. When it comes to solar parks or something with hundreds or thousands of panels, small performance boosts like this really add up. So what exactly are the implications of this study to all of us? Well, good news for team vertical bifacial photovoltaic array deployed in the east-west orientation. More power from the same footprint is obviously a win. In a vacuum, these are just plain better solar panels. Are there any downsides? Well, you could argue that since TNO's study was done entirely via computer modeling, it's not as cut and dry as it might seem at first. You could nitpick their methodology. The study notes that for 6 weeks of March and April, their physical solar panels were down, which is, you know, not ideal. I'm not suggesting that TNO has done anything less than their due diligence. My concern is that all too often in the world of emerging tech, we find something that looks amazing in the lab, but hits some kind of bump on the road to the real world. Now, unfortunately, it often pays to be a little skeptical. Now, on the other hand, bifacial vertical solar panels have been around since the 1940s and have been on the market since 1983. This is anything but a new technology, so why are they more rare than their horizontal cousins? Bifacial panels tend to be a little more expensive than your standard solar panels because they utilize advanced materials and design. That leads to increased manufacturing costs, and don't forget, these panels need their own special mounting equipment. If you want to ensure both sides of the panel are generating electricity, then there's some additional installation factors you have to consider. And since both sides of the solar panel are exposed to the elements, there's some additional lifetime maintenance you might have to perform. And taken all together, you can see why the upfront and maintenance costs tend to be higher than the norm. So yeah, vertical bifacial photovoltaic systems are not going to be the superior choice 100% of the time. However, TNO says that the cooler operating temperature of vertical bifacial PVs should result in less degradation, which could mean a longer lifetime. It's complicated. There's also some use cases where BV PVs are just plain better, so let's revisit some of those additional benefits. Vertical solar panels take up less room than horizontal. Now, you can't just cram extra solar panels into that footprint, as we mentioned earlier. They'll start blocking the sunlight and your yields will suffer. But you can share that footprint with other things as long as they don't block too much sun. So what else likes a lot of sun but isn't too tall? Well, certain low crops, such as peas and carrots, are not tall enough to block panels and benefit from the shade that the panels provide. People need energy and people need to eat, but land is a limited resource, so why not double it up? There's actually a whole subfield of solar engineering called agrivoltaics dedicated to studying the best ways to combine solar farming and, well, farming. Vertical solar panels are big in agrivoltaics because they can comfortably fit between rows of veggies. I've got an entire video on that, which I'll link to in the description. These benefits aren't limited to rural settings. Toronto is planning to deploy bifacial vertical solar panels alongside highways and train tracks as noise dampeners that can also generate some green energy. It's pretty clever. And some innovators are trying to capitalize on the more flexible footprint of vertical PV by developing smaller modules that can be deployed on an apartment's balcony. The Norwegian company Overeasy Solar has another route for BV PV cells to make it in the big city. They're manufacturing mini modules, which are smaller vertical bifacial solar panels for use on rooftops. And last year, as part of their pilot phase, they deployed a 102 kilowatt installation covering 1200 square meters on a flat roofed commercial building in Oslo. When PV Magazine mentioned the TNO study to Overeasy CEO Trygve Mongstad, he reported that he was seeing similar results with his BV PV module. Indeed, much higher than what is expected for tilted solar panels. So are vertical bifacial PVs the end-all, be-all of solar panels? No. There are likely scenarios where horizontal is likely the way to go, financially or otherwise. I'd also like to see some more tests and studies to back up TNO's study before I jump to any conclusions. As exciting as the anecdotal reports of higher yields are, they also don't really count. However, the preliminary evidence is clear. Vertical bifacial PVs are already outperforming their horizontal brothers, and the technology is only going to improve. This likely has big ramifications for solar farms and rooftop solar on commercial buildings. It's a good example of why experimentation and collaborative work can lead to some significant optimization, even in things we thought we understood pretty well. This could be vertical bifacial solar panels' time to shine. So would you want to set up vertical solar panels where you live? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every single video. Your support really does help to keep delivering these videos every week. If you'd like to support the channel and get in on the early videos, check out the link in the description. I'll see you in the next one.